last time we paid him, 150.
There's so many that need to get this song applied to.
was in the shower trying to say, well, I'm gonna dedicate this song. Let's go to the other, and I got to look. There's some men in our church that need this song. You'll know it if you apply, if it applies to you. I got thinking about our fleet of ships. We're kind of bad, the whole fleet of us are. But the anchor's still holding. They're still battling on. And that's the title of this song, The Anchor Holding.
Deanna's back there.
Okay.
Well, it's with great honor and privilege to introduce our speaker tonight, our message. I know it's going to be really great. Just be here already. So, with no further ado, I want to introduce Brother Keith Manuel. He is our Director of Evangelism and Church Growth at the Louisiana Baptist Convention. And he's been growing churches for a long time. And we definitely could use him here tonight, too, that's for sure. So, Brother Keith.
Still hopes. I can't believe it. I guess I've known you so long, I couldn't put you at 79 years old. No way in the world, you know. What does it take for God to get a hold to a man or a woman? What does it take for us to kind of just surrender ourselves to Him so that we can be used? There's a great revival that happened in 1857, 1858. Some of y'all were around when in 1982,000. I'm going to finish myself. I don't reckon any of y'all are playing that. Some of y'all watch, not all. Some of y'all may remember in 2007, I believe it was, at Kingsville Baptist Church, we had a 150th celebration that brought Dr. Roy Fish in from Southwestern Seminary. He talked about it. He did his dissertation on that. And I'm so enamored with Dr. Fish, I had to start studying on that. Some call it the Third Great Awakening. I had never heard of it. I've never heard of 1857 Layman's Prayer Revival, either, the other name for it. But they usually don't group it in with the great renewals or revivals that you study, because there was no preacher that was centered around. Wasn't a Charles Wesley or a Jonathan Edwards or some of these great preachers that you've read about, heard quoted all these years. So a guy named Jeremiah Lamphere sitting in a pew just like you. And how about this? You talk about renewal. The church was dying. All the people moved out. There were these new people from Europe moving in, all these Italians and other folks, and it's now in the Wall Street district by New York, where this little Dutch Reformed church was. It must have been a pretty thriving ministry at one point, because it's three stories to build a church building. That's pretty unheard of at that day and time, too, to have a church of that size. They must have been doing real well there, but everybody moved out. These new people speaking other languages have moved in, and so they moved out, and I guess in the suburbs, the country, whatever it was, to reorganize, and they were going to start their church, but they didn't want their church building to turn into a bar room or a business or whatnot. And so they said, I wonder if somebody would stay. And there's this guy who'd gotten saved in the church and was growing. He had a business, a general mercantile business, and he was selling all kinds of products and came from the country to make his fortune. And he was doing real well and growing in the Lord. And they said, Jeremiah, we're all leaving, but would you stay and do something with him? How about that? We're going to leave you, but we want to leave in good hands. And so, would you do something with this dead church so it didn't turn into a bar room? And you know, he said yes. Have you ever said yes to something and the next day you thought, what in the world have I gotten myself into? That had to be him. You know, it's something had to catch up with him at some point in that. So Jeremiah just started, and he was a businessman. What does a businessman do? You advertise when you go start something new. And so he printed 20,000 handbills. Now, you know what it would take to print 20,000 anything at Kinko's right now or something like that? Can you imagine in that day what it took to go run that thing off on the printing presses that they would have had to make 20,000 handbills? He invested the money and the time to do that. Distributed 20,000 handbills to invite people to come to pray. He was walking the streets one day, and he was asking God, what do I do? He said, God just put it on my mind to pray. And so he said, let's start a prayer time during lunch. And you start right at noon when you hear the whole story. Man, they had rules. Like, yeah, there were seven rules. It was hard and fast rules. Well, nothing like what we would think revival could come out of. It was really unbelievably structured. They'd sing one hymn. They'd start praying over things. If you prayed too long, I don't know what they did. I guess they give you the hook and pulled you off. You couldn't pray about anything political or controversial. And people started getting saved. Well, he went up to pray, opened the doors for the first prayer meeting. Guess how many people were there? Nobody. 20,000 handbills and advertisements later, nobody. Now, I just got to confess, I'd have pitched a fit and gone home. I'm just telling you, I'd have been mad at the world and everything else if that would happen. I'd have went to the house. He went up to that third floor and prayed. Prayed for 10 minutes, 20 minutes, right by himself, 30 minutes. And 30 minutes, he heard a couple sets of footsteps come up. It was all over. About six of them had gathered up. 20,000 handbills later. Well, how about that for your return on investment? That's not very good, is it? The cows left the chute. He did. The guys just said, hey, can we do it again? did it again. In about 6 weeks, they had packed out that little room kind of like this and had to go downstairs in the sanctuary with me. And they said after about, I think it was about the 6 weeks, they said, can we do this every day? They'd bring them lunch. They'd pray. Start praying for lost people. And they're seeing people get saved. They were amazed. Turn out that there's so many people coming. They decided they were going to rent out one of those theaters in New York in the off-Broadway district. They said, this will seat 3,000. Surely we can get them all in here and we'll have a good time. Maybe we'll have some room to grow. People were standing in the streets when we get in. The neat part about that one is you don't have to read like just secondhand accounts. If you go in and Google that, you can read newspaper accounts from that. That's what I did. And so that through that two-year, year-and-a-half period of time, 1 million people got saved. There were 100,000 people meeting in Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. God was doing it. There was one prayer meeting. This woman passed in the little card. They'd write their prayer request on it, kind of what we did. And it said, my husband is undone with the Lord. Would you pray for him? As soon as they read that, the man shot his hand up and said, I'm that guy. Another guy said, oh, no, it's not him, it's me. Six of them got saved. Just from reading that one card. Unbelievable stories. There's a guy, you know how they wrote back then. They're real formal in everything they did. And so I come across a story about a guy named Mr. Miller. And I don't even know what his first name is, but he got saved in that revival time. And he became convicted about his daddy, who was older and sick. And so he jumped on a steamship to go back to Boston to go see his daddy. The Lord kept him up all night. He said, I prayed all night long for my dad. When he got there, he saw his mother. And his mother said, what time did you start praying? And he told her whatever time it was. And he said, it was at that time that your daddy gave his life to Jesus Christ. And then went and told his sister. He told his sister what happened to himself and to his daddy. His sister got saved. They fell under conviction, said, we got an uncle out wherever, and sent him a letter. And by the time the letter went, and when it came back, they told him all about it. He said, about the time you were writing this letter, I gave my life to Jesus. They went then to see his cousin. Told his cousin about Jesus, what had happened to all their family, the uncle and his sister and his daddy and himself. And his cousin gave his life to Jesus. 2 weeks later, his cousin died. 2 weeks from Buster Delilah. At the funeral, six of his cousin's friends got to tell what happened to their family, what happened to his cousin. And then it's you know, when God gets a hold of someone, man or woman or boy or girl, and they start sharing Jesus, that's how church grows. Doesn't grow because we sing preach. Doesn't grow, because, and quite honestly, because preaching, I don't care who y'all call this preacher. You could get Billy the Grant. Well, maybe if you got Billy Grant out that might pack the room about a week or two. I'm not so sure if you even got Billy Graham out of the dead, because you know Luke chapter 16, where the man was in hell, he said, send somebody back from the dead. Amen. Tell them that. So they wouldn't believe it. They got Moses in the law. They won't believe the book. They won't believe the word. They won't believe him. Well, wasn't that a picture? Because Jesus did come back from the dead. Amen. Still don't believe him. Appeared to many for 40 days. He has showed him. He's alive, he's alive. Don't believe? Don't believe? But it doesn't mean we don't do our part. Doesn't matter how somebody responds. We're not called to respond for other people. But we are called to go. And we're called to tell. We're called to share. Because if you met the Jesus I met, you got something to say. If he's changed your life like he's changed my life, from kid running down to the little mafia-owned parlay sheep things in Biloxi, and running around like an idiot out on the roads and on Friday nights, Saturday nights, doing things that as a believer, I was a believer, I was saved 9 years old. I just wanted to be in the world for about a year and a half. I found out every night I was miserable. There's nothing. Listen, Satan will tell you, just, if you don't hear anything else, hear this, okay? And this is just an introduction. I ain't got too much yet, so y'all hang on. If you don't hear anything else, Satan will tell you just enough truth to get you to buy a lie.
Yes, he will.
Amen.
He's a liar and the father of lies, and there is no truth in him. He'll make you think something is good when it's going to tear you to pieces. You do it God's way. And so the one that bothers me more than even the sin that I see in the world is the sin that's in the church. The sin of folks who say they believe, and yet they don't ever tell. The sin of holding back. Now, you think about this now. How self-absorbed. I don't know another word other than evil. You know, live is one way, evil's the other. You decide which side of that coin's going to flip. How evil do you have to be to know about heaven and to know about hell and not tell your friends and family? I mean, how warped has Satan got into your head if you can't brag about what's in this book? And if you don't have anything to brag about in that book, you might need to check your salvation. Because Jesus sets you free. And Satan may blind you and he may lie to you, but Jesus sets you free. Satan's not the opposite of God. He doesn't have all evil power. This is not a Marvel comic book. He's a created being under the authority of Jesus. And he's allowed to roam. He's allowed to prowl. But he's nowhere close to who Jesus is.
Amen.
You better understand, he doesn't have all evil. He only has limited evil. And he's under the authority of Christ. And he will even bow and confess that Jesus Christ is Lord.
Amen.
Everybody. Every day. John chapter 1, you got your Bibles, and there's a sausage Old Testament on chairs. John, the gospel, right? So I'm gonna differentiate between two Johns we're dealing with here. So you got John the baptizer, John the Baptist, who's walking around with his disciples that's in the story. John, the gospel writer, the beloved and young apostle who rested on the bosom of Jesus, he's the one who's writing this book, and then here's right, 1st, 2nd, 3rd, John. Give us some other great information for it in the book too, don't he? But we're talking John the baptizer, the one who's dunking folks, waiting for Jesus, proclaiming Jesus. And so we pick up the story where John is doing his ministry. In verse 35, it says, and again the next day, John the baptizer, was standing with two of his disciples, and he looked at Jesus as he walked. He said, "Behold, the Lamb of God." The two disciples heard him speak, and they followed Jesus. And Jesus turned and saw them following, and said to them, "What do you seek?" You ever been caught off guard? I really think this is a kind of funny answer, because they really didn't want to know, I don't believe, what they asked. They wanted to know a lot of things about this Jesus that they've been following. But all that comes out of their mouth is, "Teacher, Rabbi, where you stay?" Did they really want to know where Jesus is sleeping? I think they got caught in a slap off guard. And what does he say? "Come, you'll see. Come on, you'll see where I'm going to stay." So they came and saw where he was staying, and they stayed with him that day, for it was about the 10th hour. One of the two who heard John speak and followed him was Andrew, Simon Peter's brother. That's important, by the way. That's important. He found first his own brother Simon. He said, "We have found the Messiah," which translated means the Christ, the one that all the Jews are waiting for, the King of Israel's here. And he said, it says he brought him to Jesus. It's pretty important right there too.
Amen.
Brought him to Jesus. Jesus looked at him and said, "You are Simon, the son of John. You shall be called Cephas," which is translated Peter. The next day, he purposed to go into Galilee, and he found Philip. And Jesus said to him, "Follow me." Now Philip was from Bethsaida, the city of Andrew and Peter. Philip found Nathanael and said to him, "We have found him of whom Moses in the law and also the prophets wrote, Jesus of Nazareth, the son of Joseph." Nathanael said to him, "Can any good thing come out of Nazareth?" Not like somebody from Lineville said, "Can any good thing come out from anybody from the Ville?"
My wife teaches there. I get it. We don't live in Lineville. Pretty close though.
Can any good? What's your rival? That's the Nazareth. That little one horse. That play. Can anything good come out of that wicked bunch? Well, what's his answer? Jesus says, "Come and see. Come check it out yourself." Jesus saw Nathanael coming to him and said to him, "Behold, an Israelite indeed, in whom there is no deceit or guile." Nathanael said to him, "How do you know me?" Nathanael's full of questions. What? Jesus answered and said to him, "Before Philip called you, when you were under the fig tree, I saw you." Nathanael answered him, "Rabbi, you are the Son of God. You are the King of Israel." Because he saw you under a tree? No, because he knew that nobody saw him under that tree. He knew he was in the presence of something greater than himself. And he suddenly trusted what his friends said. He saw who Jesus was. Let's pray. God, thank you. Thank you that your word is so powerful. Thank you, God, that you give us a great example. Father, I pray that you'll burden my heart more for the lost. Father, that you'll help me to live more saved and in the presence and the power of the Holy Spirit. Father, so that others can see Jesus in me before they die and go to a real place called heaven. Father, help my family, help my friends see Jesus in me. But God, give me the words to testify of you. Don't let me be a silent witness. Hold back the greatest message in all the world. Father, help my friends do the same, I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Hey, there's just two good lessons out of this message tonight, or out of this passage of Scripture. Pretty simple messages, really, honestly. First lesson is real simple. Family. All right, you with me? Say, "I'm listening." All right. Family ought to tell family about Jesus.
Amen.
Family ought to tell family about Jesus. Andrew, we're his first, goes and tells his brother, Peter, that we know is Peter. Some of the greatest commentators in all the world said this is probably the greatest gift to the first century church that any man gives other than what Jesus does. When Andrew goes, gets his brother, and he tells him, "Come and see Jesus." And he sees Jesus, and he knows that here is the Christ, and he surrenders to him, because the whole first book, part of the book of Acts, is about the ministry of Peter. He's the leader of the church at Jerusalem. He's the one who stands up and leads out when there's so much persecution going on, who will ultimately, tradition says, he wouldn't even allow them to crucify him upright the way Jesus was crucified. So tradition tells us he was crucified upside down. He is willing to give his life for a Jesus he met, and his brother told him. Here's the interesting thing about this passage of Scripture in the book of John. It's three times you run into Andrew and you run into Philip. And every single time they're bringing people to meet Jesus. I think that's a lesson in and of itself. Every time you hear their name mentioned in the Gospel of John, come and see. The Gentiles, "Sir, can we see Jesus?" Come on. I'll let you see Jesus. Feeding the loaves and the fishes there. Bringing people to see Jesus. Isn't that an amazing, amazing thing? Wouldn't you like that to be said about you when you're gone? That they might write a lot of things, but that they'll write maybe a couple times at least in your life. And bring people to Jesus. Come see. Okay, how do people get saved? The same old way. It's through Jesus, and I know you know that. You know it's the work of the Holy Spirit. I know you understand it takes people to bring people. When you go to the book of Acts and Peter preaches his first sermon and 3,000 are saved, why were there 3,000 baptisms on that day? Because there was at least 3,000 lost people hearing the message.
Amen. That's right.
Too many times we're preaching the message to save people. We're not getting the gospel in front of lost people. That's why we don't baptize 3,000 anymore. Preached up in Blanchard. They just did a revival, and they're not advertising it because they're on Facebook, but they got the preacher in front of the whole baseball team. 28 boys gave their lives to Christ and two coaches.
Amen.
They had almost 100 people saved. Clay Fuquay out here, now the pastor up in Blanchard. And brought in a pastor he met when he went to Israel. And he just, this guy was on the trip with him, wasn't some great evangelist. Just pastor, preached the word of God. People who were lost heard the gospel and got saved. That's why churches revive and turn around, is because you get lost people under the hearing of the word of God. See, I believe all that book, and it says faith comes by what?
Hearing.
And hearing by what? The word of God. And if you go back into that chapter just a little bit, it's like, how can they hear without a preacher? And it's not just the preacher up here, it's the preacher right here.
Amen.
Because we can go tonight, go this week, and if we just go out and tell our family about Jesus and say, come and see when they ask you, man, isn't that a bunch of hypocrites down there? Yeah, come see. You'll fit right in. Come on, join us. We'll drink coffee. Those hypocrites drink coffee and feed you. And come on. They'd love for you to be down there. You got to get excited. If you're not excited about what's going on here, why in the world do you think the world would be?
Amen.
Now, let me help you on this. Old football coach called this stinking thinking. You got to change your stinking thinking, all right? So I'm fixing to change your stinking thinking. These cars all going out here today, they're driving by right and left. And they're looking over here at you. And you know what they're thinking about you? Nothing. They're not mad you're here. Some of them are kind of quite glad you're here. They're glad the church is going on. They're glad to see cars over here. But you know what they're thinking about? How am I going to get down there and get some pizza for the school tonight because my kid's been pestering me all day and the teacher sent home notes. How am I going to get this homework done? How is the rain ever going to let up so I can go fishing? Am I ever going to get my cows out and fit out the pen? Am I going to make it to the cell? How am I going to... My son called me just before I left and said, Daddy, my truck's not working right. I said, baby, I got to go preach. You're on your own. And he's in New Orleans. I said, what you want me to do? Blow on the phone? I can't go. I'm too far away. We'll figure it out later. You know what they're thinking about you? Nothing. You're not on their radar. But they will be if you go out there. And so y'all come and say, family has to tell family, and also tell family about Jesus. Second, Philip going to get Nathaniel. Friends ought to tell friends about Jesus. Even when they look at you and say, can anything good come out of that cowboy church? Can anything good be happening down there? I mean, y'all been down there for a long time. What's going on down there? Jesus, I know most of y'all. And y'all know me. Can Jesus really change somebody like me? Can Jesus really help somebody? You know how strung out I am. You know what I've been doing. You know what my mouth is like. You know how I treat my family. Somebody like me. Yes, I do.
Amen.
They're not going to know it until you tell them.
Amen.
You say, hey, why don't you just come to it, man? I'll buy you dinner. It won't take us long. about an hour, you'd meet a friend. Maybe somebody down there does it. Maybe somebody down there needs to hire somebody. Maybe somebody down there just pat you on the back. Maybe somebody pray for you. I don't know. They've helped me. It's been good for me. That's all I can tell you. And let me help you with the other part. I honestly, in 30-plus years, I can't even think of how people do that. I can't add that fast. I run out of fingers and toes in 10, 20, you know, whatever it is. It's Mississippi math. It doesn't work very well. However many years I've been preaching and talking to folks about Jesus, I don't know. I just don't even remember. But in all those years, there's been about two who asked me some deep theological something about the Trinity or something like that. So I want to help y'all tonight with the answer to all those kinds of questions. Do your hands like this. Just participate in sport. Can you do that? Amen. If you can do this, I'm telling you, you're going to have the answer. Now do that one time. And bring it back down. Right. I don't know. That's the greatest answer you can get. You don't know? I don't know. But if that's really important to you, there's a whole passel of us down here. We'll figure it out.
Amen.
And we got the book. And if we can't find it in the book, we'll find somebody who'll help us with the book. But we'll work till we get that answer. But I don't know. I don't know the answer to all that mess. But I tell you this, what I do know, that Jesus set me free.
Amen.
We bring it back home to where it ought to be. Just talk to him like you're supposed to talk to him. It's like being in the South. My mama, you take her anywhere. And I'm telling you, she found kin and friends at every Walmart. I can get her out of the store. She's going to talk to somebody. And just being from the South, you're just friendly. Well, what kind of friend are you if you're not going to tell them about Jesus? You might be friendly, but are you really a friend? If you don't tell your friend. You see, there's a real place called heaven. Jesus said, let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God? Believe in me too.
Amen.
In my Father's house, you're in mansions.
Amen.
If it were not so, I would have told you. I go and prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I'll come again. And I'll receive you to myself. That where I am, there you can be also. And where I'm going, you know. And the way, you know. There's old Thomas. We call him Doubting Thomas. He's bold. I don't know what you're talking about. How can I know the way if I don't even know what you're talking about? He says, that's all right, Thomas. I'm the way. I'm the truth. I'm the life. No man, woman, boy, or girl comes to the Father except for there's your story. I got to come through Jesus. Don't deserve it. Shouldn't be allowed in. Even today, shouldn't. Don't do the very thing I should. But God takes those who are broken and He restores them. And He makes them whole. And He uses people like you to see the world. What a man or woman or a girl gives their life to Jesus. And I'm telling you, He'll do it. But you just got to tell it. I met Jesus. And we're going to sing about Jesus. We're going to talk about Jesus. We're going to rope for Jesus. We're going to ride for Jesus. We're going to work for Jesus. We're going to serve for Jesus. Man, and I need some help. Would you just come help me? And let's go do this together. We've been doing stuff all our life. And maybe you'll meet Jesus, man. And will He take somebody? Well, just come and see. Come and see. Because I did, and I promise you, I'm going to do it. And you see my life change. That's all you got to do. You don't have to know everything about Jesus. But you do know what you know about Jesus. Tell that. It's the same old story for every man, woman, boy, and girl. Through the same person, Jesus, that allow you to go to a real place called heaven. So you finish the real place called heaven. And takes the hell of earth and makes it back. something coming. There's a storm coming your way, and it's brewing right now. And you can try to do it by yourself, or you can do it with the Comforter. Love you. He cares for you. And he's good for you. And if you don't know Jesus tonight, I beg you, come to know for yourself. Not the storyteller Jesus, not the story of Jesus, but the man, Jesus,
amen,
who is the Son of God, who takes away the sins of the world. I'm going to ask you to bow your heads and close your eyes. Tonight, there's one here, and I know probably a lot of church folks here. If you're here tonight, maybe somebody invited you. And you don't know Jesus as your personal Lord and Savior. Maybe you've been in church for a long time. And it hadn't become real for you. You thought Jesus didn't want anybody like me. I want you to know tonight Jesus wants you. He loves you. The Bible says he loves you so much he demonstrated it by dying on the cross just for you. And if whoever calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. But to repent means that you do more than say you're sorry. It's a change of your mind about who Jesus is that then changes your heart so that you surrender your life to follow him. That leads to a change of actions by your hands and your feet. You live different. That's what real repentance is. That you surrender to Jesus as Lord and Savior. I prayed a prayer like this. I just said, dear Jesus, I was 9 years old. Dear Jesus, what do you say? I need a Savior. I need to be set free from my sin. I ask you to give me a place in your heaven. I give you my life today. I ask you to come into my heart. And I pray in Jesus' name. Maybe you need to pray a prayer just like that. Just say it in your own heart right now. Dear Jesus, I ask you to save me. I ask you to forgive me of my sins. I ask you to come into my heart and take up residence there. I choose today you and to choose to turn away from sin. I receive the message of hope that's in your Bible. And I want to know that my name is written in the Lamb's Book of Life tonight. God, will you save me? Sir, I'm just going to ask you tonight if you prayed with me just now, if you really meant it. I'm telling you, every head is bowed. Eyes closed right now. If that was you and you prayed and you meant it for the first time, would you just slip up your hand? Is there anybody? Yes, son, I see. Anybody else for the first time? Let me ask you this. Maybe you're like me. You let the world slip in. I was a kid. Maybe you're an adult. Maybe you are a kid. You've let some things steal the joy of your salvation. You've let Satan steal the beauty of the Bible, reading it. You've let Satan stole the wonder of prayer and talking to God, the wonder of sharing the joy of Jesus. You just need a fresh start. You say, preacher, pray for me. And just slip your hand up. It's really for you and God. Slip your hand up and say, pray for me, preacher. I just need a fresh start. I'm not going to make you come down to the front or do anything. Anybody tonight to say, I need a fresh start, get some money. Anybody else before I pray? You want to be counted in on that prayer? You need a fresh start, fresh bit. The Holy Spirit of God, yes, I see that. Thank you. Anybody else before I pray? I don't want to leave anybody out, but I'm not going to hesitate much longer. Anybody else? Heavenly Father, thank you for this young man. One young man said, needed Jesus. I said, thank you, dear. So, God, I pray that if that's his call, and that's what he's doing right now, Father, that you'll make him into a great man of God. Be willing to step forward and do the things that you would ask him to do as a man of God. Father, I pray for these. Let raise your hand and say, I just need a fresh start, Jesus, with God. Oh, I got family, I got friends, I got others that I need to be an example before. So God, I pray that you'll restore the joy of their salvation the way that David prayed. God, that you'll renew a right spirit within them, that they will just long and desire to do the things that God would have them to do. Father, would you bless them now? In Jesus' name. God bless this church. May they go forth and may you bear much fruit through them. In Jesus' name. Amen. God bless.